Hi, I'm Bill Spaulding. Welcome to WCS Money Tutorials. In 2023, bonds are becoming a great investment, but the taxation of bonds is more complicated than it is for stocks. The purpose of this video is to provide a conceptual overview of bond taxation, including the three types of interest, how capital gains or losses are calculated, and how taxable income is reported. Bond taxation is complex, with many laws or regulations specific to certain types of bonds, including bonds issued before or after certain time periods. This video does not cover these specific laws, since they would not apply to most people. Links for much more detailed information are provided in the description of this video. Bond taxation is complex because there are six primary factors affecting taxation: accrued interest, whether the bond is an original discount or coupon bond, whether the bond was acquired at a market discount or premium, the issuer, the type of bond, and the issue date of the bond. There are four types of taxable bond income. Most bonds pay interest periodically, usually twice annually, and is taxed as ordinary income. When bonds are purchased at a discount, then there will be a gain at maturity. However, this gain is treated like interest, as ordinary taxable income. Unlike stocks, it is not treated as a capital gain. However, the reported discount income is added to your tax basis, which reduces capital gains or increases capital losses. Capital gain or loss can only be determined after accounting for discount interest. The simplest case of bond taxation is that of coupon bonds purchased for face value. Because all the interest is paid periodically, usually semi-annually, there are no discount interest complications. However, bonds purchased in between interest payment dates will include accrued interest. Accrued interest steadily increases until the next payment date, when it drops to zero on that date, then starts increasing again, and so on. Knowing what part of the purchase or sale price is accrued interest is important for calculating taxes. For the buyer, the accrued interest of the purchased bond is treated as a return of capital, so the buyer can subtract the accrued interest from the interest reported on Form 1099 INT. The buyer's adjusted basis in the bond is reduced by the same amount. The seller must report that part of the sales proceeds attributable to the accrued interest as ordinary interest income. You do not have to worry about calculating the accrued interest, since most bond listings display the accrued interest for a given settlement date, as you can see in this TD Ameritrade listing for a Microsoft bond. You could also use the bond calculator. Click the link, and the calculator will be filled with the appropriate information that you are looking at. Enter the relevant information, then click Calculate. Note that the accrued interest is for every $1,000 worth of principal, which applies to most corporate bonds, even though this calculator is displaying a price of $100. So you must be wary of little idiosyncrasies like this. Accrued interest must be subtracted from the total interest, which is done on Schedule B of Form 1040. Although most of you will use tax software to file your taxes, you should make sure that the software treats accrued interest correctly. This example will show how accrued interest affects taxes. Joe sells his bond to Sally. Details are shown on the screen. Joe reports interest of $30, even though he receives the interest payment as part of the sale price. Therefore, the sale amount is reduced by the amount of the accrued interest, leaving a capital gain of $10. Sally paid $1,040 for the bond, but her tax basis is reduced by the $30 of accrued interest, so she must subtract $1,010 from the sale or redemption price to determine her capital gain or loss when the bond is disposed of. So, if Sally holds the bond until maturity, then she would report a capital loss of $10. Original issue discount bonds are bonds issued at a discount to the face value of the bond, such as zero coupon bonds and treasury bills. The OID discount is treated as interest. The total OID interest equals the redemption value minus the issue price. No OID interest is reported for most tax-exempt securities, United States savings bonds, and short-term debt securities, with terms not exceeding 1 year from date of issuance. OID accrues every day and is added to the adjusted tax basis of the bond. This accrued OID is taxed annually as interest. The total accrued OID can be approximated using the first formula, but the more complicated constant yield method is used for actual calculations. You do not need to figure this yourself, since your broker will list the accrued OID in Form 1099 OID that you will receive after the end of the tax year. Sometimes, the market price of a bond is less than the face value or even the issue price. This is referred to as a market discount price. Market discount bonds differ from OID bonds in two important ways. Market discount income is still counted as interest, but the discount accrual period ranges from the purchase date rather than the issue date to the maturity date. The other difference is that market discount income can be reported either annually or when the bond is sold or reaches maturity. This election must apply to all market discount bonds acquired on or after the first day, the first taxable year, to which the election applies. There are two methods for determining the accrued market discount, ratable accrual method and the constant yield method. The ratable accrual method simply divides a market discount by the number of days between the maturity date and the purchase date, multiplied by the number of days the bond was actually held. So, if the market discount is $100 and the number of days between the purchase date and maturity date is 200 days, and you have held the bond for 100 days, then the accrued market discount equals $50. The constant yield method is most used. It is the method your broker will use unless you instruct it to use the ratable accrual method. Accrued OID is also based on the constant yield method. You do not need to figure this yourself, since your broker will list the accrued market discount in Form 1099 OID that you will receive after the end of the tax year. Original issue discount bonds may also drop in price because of lower demand, so they will have both an OID discount and a market discount. The OID is treated under the usual rules, but the market discount is increased by accrued OID. The market discount of an OID bond equals the issue price plus the accrued OID includable in the gross income of all prior holders of the bond, minus the bond price. You need to know how much of the discount is OID and how much is market discount, so that you know how much interest to claim each year. Only the OID interest needs to be claimed annually. In this example, an OID bond with a face value of $1,000 and an issue price of $800 is purchased for $700, a total discount of $300. We assume the bond has accrued OID equal to $25 at the time of purchase, which increases the market discount by the same amount. Note that the original OID is reduced by the $25 accrued OID, yielding $175 for remaining OID. Adding the $125 market discount equals the $300 total discount price. Freeze the screen if you would like to study this in more detail. Since OID interest and market discount interest are treated similarly, you can elect to treat all such interest as OID to simplify reporting. There is a de minimis value for both OID and market discounts. If the discount is less than the de minimis value, then the value can be treated as zero for the annual reporting of interest. Note, however, that the de minimis value for a market discount uses the number of days from the purchase date to the maturity date, whereas the de minimis value for OID equals the number of days from the issue date to maturity. If the de minimis value is not reported as interest, then it must be reported as a capital gain if held to maturity or when the bond is sold. Capital gain or loss can only be calculated after accounting for purchase price, accrued OID, and accrued market discount. Here are a couple examples to illustrate. Case 1. You buy a bond for $800 with a remaining term at purchase of 10 years, and you hold the bond until maturity. Therefore, the $200 purchase discount is treated as interest, whether the discount is OID or a market discount, or a combination of the two. Because your adjusted basis is increased by the amount of the accrued discount interest, which is taxed as ordinary income, your redemption amount equals your adjusted basis, so you have no capital gain or loss. Case 2 is the same as Case 1, but you sell the bond for $950 after holding it for 5 years. Since your holding period is only 50% of the original remaining term, your discount interest equals 50% of the purchase discount, or $100, which is added to your basis. Therefore, your capital gain equals the sale price minus your adjusted basis of $900 equals $50. Case 3 is the same as Case 2, except the sale price equals $875. Therefore, you have a long-term capital loss of $25. Property with capital gains or losses are reported in detail in Form 8949, then summarized in Schedule D, Capital Gains and Losses. Sometimes, bonds are bought at a premium, meaning that the purchase price was higher than the face value. This happens because interest rates have declined, but the bond is still paying a higher coupon rate. You can choose to include the premium in your adjusted basis, which will reduce your taxable income when the bond matures or when it is sold. Or you can amortize the premium by deducting a pro rata portion of the premium every year from your interest income. The amortized premium can be used to reduce the taxable annual interest income and to reduce the tax basis. If the premium is not amortized, then the premium will be a capital loss at maturity. This is a simple example on how to amortize a bond premium. Amortizing the premium allows you to deduct $10 annually from your taxable interest. Freeze the screen to study it in detail. Although there is no deduction for amortizing tax-exempt bonds, the purchase premium must still be used to reduce tax basis, which reduces reported tax-exempt interest. This may be important for determining modified adjusted gross income, often used to determine other credits or deductions. Interest and bond premiums are reported in Form 1099. For bonds purchased at a premium, the custodian may report all interest in Box 1, or the custodian may report net interest in Box 1 and the amortized premium in Box 11. You amortize the bond premium on Schedule B on Form 1040 by totaling the interest, then subtracting the amortized bond premium, writing ABP adjustment beside the subtracted amount. Some municipal bonds are exempt from federal taxes, including the 3.8% net investment income tax. Some municipal bonds are also exempt from state and local taxes. Triple exemption depends on the type of bond, issuer, and whether the taxpayer lives within the municipality of the issuer. Treasuries issued by the federal government are exempt from state and local taxes. Only income paid by the government issuer on tax-exempt bonds is tax-exempt, including adjustments of principal for Treasury inflation-protected securities. Capital gains from the sale of tax-exempt bonds is never tax-exempt because the money is paid by a buyer of the bond rather than by the government issuer. For a similar reason, market discount interest is not paid by the issuer, but results from market conditions, so it is not tax-exempt. OID is reported on Form 1099 OID from your custodian, showing accrued OID in Box 1, interest payments in Box 2, market discounts in Box 5, and acquisition premium in Box 6.
Although it is not necessary, some custodians may choose to report the annual payment of interest separately.
If interest is not reported on Form 1099 OID, then the interest income is reported on Form 1099 INT in Box 1. Even though tax-exempt interest is not taxable, it still must be reported. Thank you very much for your time. If you liked my video, please give me a thumbs up and subscribe. I would appreciate any suggestions, so please leave them in the comments below. Check out my website at thismatter.com for more than 850 in-depth fundamental tutorials on personal finance, investments, and economics. Check out my books on money at williamspaulding.com. Thank you.